YouTube, Jinji here. If you're new, welcome to my channel. And if you've been here for a while, thank you so much for your continued love and support. For today's second installment in my self-improvement series, I'm going to be talking about the ways I've been building resilience during lockdown. And this is a skill that I've actually had to practice a lot in the past 2 weeks. I won't go into the details out of respect for privacy for the person, but a very close family member of mine was recently hospitalized. In addition to the emotional upheaval I've been feeling as a result of her health crisis, I've also been feeling the psychological, mental, and financial stress because as a result, I'm now living alone. And for me, as someone who thrives on social interaction, I would never have lived alone by choice even before coronavirus. But being forced to live alone now, even if it's only for a temporary period of time, it's still been really difficult, especially when I'm having to work out my feelings and figure out how to deal with the stress of this person's health crisis on my own. But in addition to all the other healthy habits that I've built into my routine to keep me going, I also have been telling myself that I haven't come this far and survived childhood trauma, bullying, and abuse just to fold now. I know that I'm strong and resilient. Even though I might need a little help sometimes, I know that I can make it through. And with that said, let's dive right into today's topic. First, I think we have to define what resiliency is. I think for many of us, the definition of resiliency that we've learned is that you're supposed to keep a stiff upper lip, be tough, and not show any emotion. And in fact, it's just the opposite, because resiliency looks different for everyone. For some people, it might mean crying when they need to. For others, it might mean journaling or meditating when they feel stressed. For another person, it might mean taking a leave of absence from work. And still for other people, it might mean doing a combination of all these activities. Because the whole point of resiliency isn't to be tough per se, but it's finding ways to maintain psychological, spiritual, mental, and emotional health in the face of adversity. Now here's some good news. Research in neuroscience has actually shown that if you are intentionally changing your thoughts and behaviors, you can develop resiliency. If you are constantly training your brain with good habits and behaviors through the process of neuroplasticity, which is your brain's ability to form and reorganize synaptic connections, you can develop more resiliency over time. With that said, here are some ways I've been building pockets of peace into my everyday, some of which are backed by the American Psychological Association. So one thing I've been doing is making sure that I have a healthy mental diet. And just like I said in the first video of this series, I think we are living in this era where people are reading the labels on groceries, nutrition facts, trying to find out if something is non-GMO or organic before they put it in their body. And I truly do believe that we should be taking the same approach with things we read or watch, because we also don't want our brain to consume junk. So for me right now, I am choosing not to read any news for the sake of my mental health. I know that because we are in the middle of a worldwide pandemic, that there will be bad news about people dying or losing loved ones. And although I do believe it is important to stay informed, I know my mental health should be the first priority. And I know there are good things happening more than what is reported in mainstream media. However, even if it's just a little bit, I don't want to be negatively influenced by those things. The second habit I've been incorporating into my lifestyle is making sure to adjust my goals and expectations. And honestly, this has probably been the hardest thing for me to do. And to clarify, I'm not dropping all those things that I'm doing, all those projects, because those still fulfill my spiritual and creative needs. What I'm doing is just scaling things back a little bit. Maybe I don't have to work on this YouTube video that's not due for another 3-4 weeks. Maybe I can just work on the one that's due right now. So that's just one example of something I'm doing for myself. But overall, the main point is that if you're going through a really tough time, you shouldn't feel bad or guilty for scaling down your workload. Another strategy for building resilience is to incorporate a mindfulness exercise into each day. When I feel like my mind is racing with thoughts or I'm feeling overwhelmed, I've found that journaling is a really good emotional release for me. Psychologists at UCLA conducted research on journaling and found that anxiety and cognitive functions actually improved with expressive writing. More specifically, they looked at the brain imaging of people undergoing journal therapy. What they found was that written words actually helped make traumatic experiences less intense. Researcher and professor Matthew Lieberman of UCLA was quoted as saying, "In the same way you hit the brake when you're driving when you see a yellow light, when you put feelings into words, you seem to be hitting the brake on your emotional responses." And really quick, I want to just take a moment here to say that if you are enjoying this video and learning something, please do take a moment to like, comment, subscribe, and share if you feel so compelled, and help my message reach more people. Thank you! Now let's get back to the video. And now, probably the most underrated strategy to build resilience in my opinion, and in general just to build happiness, is to practice an attitude of gratitude. When I first learned about the scientific research showing the benefits of maintaining an attitude of gratitude, I started consciously making a list of 10 things I felt grateful for whenever I felt down or upset. And personally, I have found that even if it's only a little bit, it actually does help improve my mood. And there's actually lots of research to back this up. There was actually a study conducted at Berkeley where they had a large pool of students compose gratitude letters. What they found was that gratefulness was an effective mood enhancer even for people with mental health concerns. There's also been a compelling body of evidence over the years from multiple studies that show that people who regularly practice gratitude tend to be happier. Our next building block of resilience is to forge connections or lean on the ones you already have. I'm not gonna lie, it's really difficult for me sometimes to reach out to people around me because most of the time I wanna be alone with my thoughts and contemplate things without any outside influence. So sometimes I do have to force myself to socialize a little bit. Psychologist Susan Pinker says that face-to-face contact is like a vaccine because when we communicate with another person face-to-face, a combination of neurotransmitters that can relieve anxiety and stress are released, which can make us more resilient to stress factors in the long run. Now, obviously, as I said earlier, we are in the middle of a pandemic, so the way that we maintain our social connections is gonna look a little different. So right now, for myself personally, I am video calling my friends when I feel like I need extra emotional support, and also I've actually started writing letters to some of them as well, which is something that I always love to do but hadn't really made time for recently, and I find that doing those things has made me feel less isolated. And another suggestion from the American Psychological Association that's helpful is to join a group that will give you a sense of purpose and joy when you need it. Now, I've actually been involved with a mutual aid group that distributes 700 to 800 meals a week to unhoused people in our community. But because of everything that's been going on with my family member's health crisis, I have taken a break for the past 2 weeks. However, after taking some time to realign myself mentally, spiritually, emotionally, I do feel ready to come back, and I'm really looking forward to it because I know that the people that I work with are really genuinely, truly honest and good people. And I know that being around them will remind me that there is still goodness and light in the world, which I know will help me definitely maintain a positive outlook during this challenging time. I know that sometimes you might be going through a lot of pain and that might make you feel like withdrawing or isolating yourself, but again, it's really important to reach out when you need help or extra support because you need a reminder that you're not alone. You're never alone because there's always so many people who care about you more than you think. And just from being out in the world, socially distanced, of course, you will see so many reminders that there are still many good people and wonderful things happening today. Thanks so much for tuning in. That's all I have to share for today. I hope you learned something. Aside from the technical aspects of making this video, it was really difficult to finish because it's directly related to things that are happening in my life right now. And I even briefly considered scrapping this video entirely, but I'm really glad I didn't. Now that I'm almost completely done with it, I feel like making this video was actually like a really long therapy session, and it does make me feel really good that I pushed through, and I hope that this video also serves as an example and a testament to the endurance of human strength and perseverance. I hope that this video helps you or others in some way, and if you enjoyed it, please do like, comment, subscribe, and share to help my message reach more people out there. Thank you so much for tuning in. I'll see you all next time. Onwards and upwards.